About to give you one small scenario. It's Sunday morning and there's this corporate group that you all take for a beautiful, you know, rock climbing, rappelling expedition. Beautiful morning, it's not raining, it's shining, nice weather, and suddenly there is this person who says, I'm from the government sports department and I want to see your permit. And you say, oh, Rajesh, wo permit kahan hai? Yaar, maine to wo Rakesh ko bola tha. Rakesh, nahi sir, wo office ki meeting thi na, usliye ja nahi saka. Friday, the whole day there was an office meeting, and the office person could not go and get the permit. Forget Sunday's outing. Monday morning, you find this person behind bars. The unfortunate part is that if the GR in its present state comes through, this might become a reality. We have a distinguished set of speakers today. We have Shantanu, Mrudul, and Rajesh Gadgil. The three of them are going to give us a little insight into this not so scary GR, don't worry about it. And we also have Subodh sir from MTDC. He is going to take points from you. He is going to take home messages from you in case you make any. Shantanu is a person who is living a dream life. You know, there's always a saying that anyone can do what he likes, but few people can like what they do. And Shantanu is actually doing that. Shantanu is amongst those lucky few who has lived his passion and is making a living out of his passion. I would like to invite Shantanu to take up his position on GR. We start with Shantanu first.
I'm struggling with the fact that a lot of points that I had have already been spoken. They have been made. In more than one way, I'm extremely glad. It reinforces a lot of thoughts one has, and I have a lot of self-doubt about, hey, you know what, I'm making this presentation sitting at home, and this is what I'm writing, and is this right? Will I rub people the wrong way? So I'm so glad to have heard a lot of same thoughts being expressed. I've tried to avoid those and sort of rush through the presentation. One thing that I would like to start off with was Colonel Chadha mentioned about hypothermia, and I do not know many of the people here, but generally there was a thought long time back, at least, I don't know how it is today, that hypothermia happens in the Himalaya. But there is a person here called Charuhas Joshi who is sitting here, and Charu and I, we have handled one hypothermia case in the Sahyadri at a pretty close to Saswad, and it had progressed in the first aid language from mild to moderate symptoms, signs and symptoms. Today, I think, looking at the whole history of the incident, if Charu and I, we had not acted upon it, perhaps the person would have slid down from moderate to severe hypothermia because it lasted a few hours. And so this one argument could be, oh, but you know, this was at Saswad. So you have the Deccan Plateau and then you have the Saswad Plateau. But something very similar happened to two girls who were on a monsoon outing in Kondana, which is in the coastal plains. I think why I thought I should make this point was sometimes we grow up with certain myths or with certain beliefs which could be completely wrong. And as they say, emergency happens when you least expect it. It is this conceptual misunderstanding that might land our group members into something as severe as hypothermia, even in the Western Ghats. Okay. So I thought I'll start with that. Lot of repetitions. I think I'm also going to take the liberty of raising a few questions, including to people who are here in this hall. And that also includes me. So let's move on and see. This has been repeated. Yes, yes, yes. probably the last is something that is being discussed fiercely in Maharashtra. So, a lot of kinds of classifications for risk or safety and or safety. So this is the way I look at it. Are we as organizers and as instructors and as leaders, etc., etc., aware that I'm also looking at emotional safety of children, of people coming with me? Are they coming on a holiday, or am I conducting a course where I have to drive a curriculum? Are these distinctions clear in my head? And then these two things. So the golden rule, which is taught in all mountaineering institutes, safety of people, safety of environment, and safety of equipment. So if we look at risk management, we have to perforce look at all these three always, always. There is a danger sometimes that we tend to look only at people. And usme bhi danger kya hai? We tend to look at danger of customers. And which is why all wilderness first aid courses start by saying, hey, you know what? If there is an emergency, stop. Ensure that you are safe. And you, when you enter, are going to be safe. You do not create more casualties. So, what are the limiting factors to my understanding of safety? Organizational health. Again, people have talked a lot. I'm just going to tell you one statement here, which I heard in a very similar conclave conducted in Bangalore last month. This apparently was Richard Branson. Train people so that they can easily leave your organization. But treat them so that they find it hard to do so. What an amazing statement. I'm saying this because my own friends in this industry always have said, hey, you know what? Training programs, except if it is subsidized, basic and advanced, are very costly. And if I train, these guys go out and start their own organization. And then some words that came up, my organizational memory, my organizational strengths are walking out. So, which is why I thought we need to seriously think about a lot of these things, and I think Mr. Nayan Kotian made some remarkable points. Directly connected to finances, pricing, etc., etc. Okay, soft skills. One thing that has not come up throughout this day is children. Many of our organizations, we conduct camps titled variously for children. Probably more about that as we go along, if there is a queue. So the fact is, now we are facing a GR, period. I think we should start with the simple thing, ki everybody, including government employees, want this. We need good risk management in order to enhance safety in adventure. I don't think we can doubt this part. I don't think there is anybody out there saying, hey, you know what, adventure should be completely unsafe. Let them go and kill people. No, we don't have stuff like that. So let us, now this is where my thoughts start coming in. This is where I'm saying, hey, I'm going to present some thoughts. You think about it. Why did the GR come about at all? And when some of us were sitting down to discuss a lot of things and generate a lot of things while the GR was being formed, we obviously studied some things which happened abroad. And Mrudul Modi is going to present a comparative study of something that happened in one of the Western countries. In Maharashtra, why did the GR come about at all? So for the sake of argument and taking things forward, let us consider us adventurers and them government. And one of the previous slides, yeah, I had put a mark against adventure. So what I want to say is, when I say adventure, it's everybody. So we are talking of outdoor educationists, we are talking of adventurers, rock climbers, kayakers, rafters, paragliders, now we have skydivers. everybody. For the sake of brevity, let us move on with the word adventure and adventurers. And then obviously I'm not making a distinction between people who operate in the field of adventure for commercial gains and people who are now starting calling themselves do-it-yourself people, the club people. So here is a perspective. For me, the GR is an effect. There are many other effects, illnesses, injuries, accidents, fatalities. The GR is an effect. And the cause lies, perhaps, this frankly came about while seriously I was preparing for this presentation that, hey, you know, what do I think about this whole thing? I have underlined certain words and I would like to tell you what these mean to me. One thing is establish and demonstrate. It should be seen. It should be seen by the government. It should be seen by the records of safety that have been demonstrated over a period of years that, hey, you know what, we operate safely. Look at the number of illnesses we have had. Look at the number of injuries we have had. Look at the way we have handled mishaps. And I think one thing that sometimes or many a times we miss is look at the joy with which people are coming back. Because an illness, injury, fatality is very far. Here is the sheer joy that people feel and children come back saying, hey, you know, we want to go back. But I've seen children say, hum kabhi nahi jayenge abhi. There were blisters. People were wearing high-heeled shoes. I mean, girls. People were wearing long clothes. The works and established clubs and companies operating programs for children. So we are not talking of illnesses and injuries which require mega reports and debriefing and critical incident reviews and all that. The sheer joy which needs to be given needs to be demonstrated to an adequate level. And I'm writing uniformly because there are organizations which function beautifully. But when we look at industry levels, this word becomes crucial. This word becomes also crucial because, to my perception, the adequate level of networking amongst organizations perhaps is not happening. Point to ponder. Maybe it's just my opinion. But I need to desperately learn from others. How are you making things so beautiful? Why is your brand name suddenly, you know, such a big thing? What are the factors? Let me understand them. And the flip side. Why did this accident happen? And there need to be networking platforms. So again, adequate level shayad nahi ho raha hai. And inconsistently. In a way, we fail to regulate ourselves. So I thought, let me just quickly put this because we are also, I mean, I would like to look at individual organizations and associations like ATOM, Akhil Maharashtra Giriyaron Mahasangha, AMGM, ATAOI, and the government. So it's everybody, individuals as well as organizations. Now, one of the things that I learned in the last conclave in Bangalore, that conclave incidentally was on experiential education. It's going to happen next year again in January. Some really great people came to talk. And I would really strongly encourage people to be a part of the next conclave. Okay, so there one thing that I learned was, I think it was the US, the UK, Canada, and perhaps Scandinavian countries. The graph of adventure and adventure-related fields grows. And one day, litigation seems to be a part of that graph. This world-class adventurers and experiential educationists from the US were presenting on data collected and analyzed for a period of almost a decade or more. And they cited examples of how UK, for instance, things were already on the downslide and they provided a lot of illustrations and all that. So maybe Maharashtra, this has hit us. Enough has been said about no reliable data. What is known is 1998-99 was the first time that the topic of GR was broached. It was during two seminars, jointly conducted by Indian Mountaineering Foundation and Himalayan Club, happened very, very drastically similar to why the present GR has come about at all. So somebody quickly mentioned that the present GR, the direct relation of why it has come about is a very sad case of a young teenager who died because of some pulmonary, some high altitude related illness. Very, very similar altitude, exactly the same age, 1998-99. The father of the boy, he opened the seminar in Mumbai by saying something amazing. He said, you know what, after all the pain was handled and we wanted to sue the organization, and they went and had a dialogue. And then he made a really, really fascinating statement which points at all of us. He said, you know what, there is no point in suing them, because I came to realize that these guys are completely ignorant about acclimatization, how to manage acclimatization in others especially. So when I'm leading people up, you know, at 8,000, 10,000, 12,000 high altitude treks. And then he said, then I realized my fight is not against these people. My fight is against ignorance. And he went into a very, very impassioned drive of trying to educate all of us. He sent posters and tabhi internet chalu hua tha. So I don't think he sent internet links, but he sent posters and booklets and whatnot to schools, to organizations operating in the outdoors, to clubs, so on and so forth. Why I'm saying this is, in my mind, I'm saying, yahan se yahan tak humne kya kiya? Which takes me back to the demonstrable thing. What did we do? What did we demonstrate? Seminar to ho gaya. Is a question that we perhaps need to ponder upon. So, for me, it's great. This GR makes us pause. So I don't know if I can explain things about the GR. This is not the forum. But for me, this is a fantastic pause. And we are all in this world. And maybe I missed out a few terms. So the individuals that are operating, either as activity experts, leaders, freelancers, company owners, as Colonel Chadda pointed out, it all begins from us. We should. Now, if you go to any typical HR scenario, a company scenario, boss, ye to sab pata hai humko. Why are we talking about this? Stakes are too high. We should, because we are not demonstrated. And some things that some speakers have talked about, this, please, I'm just taking an example. What I desperately want to say is support Colonel Chadda's statement, why training is good. I have personally hit so many hurdles against training. I'll give you just one example. In 2001, one American organization called Wilderness Medicine Institute came and conducted a wilderness first aid course in India for the first time. A four-day intensive 60% scenario-based hands-on wilderness first aid medicine recognized by the top organizations in the US. The first course happened in Bangalore and in Mumbai in 2001. The certificate is valid only for 2 years. So they said, through their India branch, they will conduct every 2 years a recertification process and fresh courses for new people. Every 2 years, Bangalore conducted recertification courses as well as fresh courses, including 10-day courses, which cost a tremendous amount of money. Mumbai, nothing. No outdoor organization ever even considered recertifying. The 2001 course happened. Recertification nahi hua, fresh ki to baat hi chodo. It took YMCA to bring them, I think, 4 years back. Now, last year, the second course through YMCA happened. But YMCA is a whole lot of things than just outdoor organization. Where are the clubs? Where are the commercial organizations? Where are the individuals who are manning associations? So, yeah. I don't know why I went off at that tangent, but this is a fact. So we need to ponder, where are we in this whole picture of growth when Maharashtra is actually showing the litigation square that people are presenting as data, which has already happened in the Western world. We need to learn from them. So just as an example, I thought, so this is a typical model, and you can Google and get loads of stuff on this. So very simplified model. Let us say motorcycle. I start driving a motorcycle. I'm struggling with the gears, and my pillion rider, who's an expert, says, "Hey, you know, now change into second gear." And I start looking down, and I get into the middle of the road. That is a novice, and a master is where I'm discussing such topics passionately and driving through, Dadar ka Kohinoor market or Pune ka Lakshmi Road. What are the hazards here? Again, touched upon by some people, but some structured way of training gives clarity and makes me more self-aware as an individual, where maybe there are a large many novices or apprentices declaring themselves to be masters and saying, "Come with me, let's go to the Himalaya. Let's go on a high altitude trek." Who will do this check? So at the moment, I'm doing a risk management review and training process for a chain of hotels. And somebody up there in the company is trying to push down review and training at various adventure locations. Phone pe jab baat hoti hai, to all, I've done 3 locations till now. Tino locations mein jawab aa gaya, "Oh, but our people are trained." Oh, then I say, "Oh, okay, yeah, they're trained. Maybe they are here. Maybe they are here. What are the criteria? Can you make this guy talk philosophy while attaching a descender on your artificial rock surface and have your client rappel down?" Organizational level is complete ignorance maybe about all this. So how does the organization recruit freelancers? How does the organization, have a training and development plan for people? "Oh no, paisa nahi hai lekin." So I think these are some of the hazards. Sticking to just one example and one or two things spin off from that. And just quickly telling you, I'm going to connect this later. So this is another model which says, "Hey, you know, okay, this is great gyan. Now where do I stand? Maybe my skill level is very high. But you know what? When I work with, Rajesh Gadgil, my willingness drops. We got some issues. But the cause is that. The cause is not my willingness. Ye aadmi, you all know, na, ye gadha kaun laake bithaya apne team mein? Low on skill and low on willingness. So this is a great self-awareness tool, and I thought, let me quickly share it. Also for organizations, what is the goal clarity, processes and symptoms? Do we have it across functions? This is crucial, seeking, nurturing competence and talent. Maintaining integrity through written and demonstrated values and principles. Some speaker mentioned this really strongly, that we need to have principles and values written down. And what is demonstrated? Each action taken by my team member on the field reflects the safety standards that my organization claims, reflects the values, customer service, joy in the outdoors, so on and so forth. Each step, each action, and there are many more. Two things that I would like to cite. If we don't do this, then we fall prey to license raj. There is an organization called Kaveri Institute in Pune. They do a year-long diploma in outdoor education. Their name is listed in the guidelines that are an appendix to the GR. So this person who conducts the course calls up and says, "Hey, you know what, Shantanu? This year, suddenly we were flooded with inquiries because of the publication of that document, and now I had to close admissions. Isse pehle, it was a struggle to get adequate number of people. The rock climbing course conducted by Giri Vihar suddenly has people who never, or probably because they have a profile of typical participant on a rock climbing course, their profile has changed. And people actually are making statements, "Ke abhi to sabko certificate chahiye na, GR aa gaya." So unless we are self-regulated, unless we have our goals really clear about why we are in this field, we may fall into the trap of license raj without even realizing it. I thought I should state this because if I am aware that I am humble and I am self-aware, I will probably make a check about am I an apprentice or a novice or whatever. Personally, I have experienced this working with a foreign organization, which is a 50-year-old organization in the field of outdoor leadership. And frankly, all this was taught to me by them, and all this was made to practice. I mean, all this I have practiced under guidance, mentoring, so on and so forth, on the field. So what does judgment mean? In one model, it is training, it is experience. And experience is practice, 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 practice. And more importantly, the organization should enable this person and the organization to reflect on the experience that has come after the training. A lot of study, a lot of mentoring that happens on the field, that perpetually keeps increasing the judgment. Mrudul, I'm not sure if you're going to touch on this, but somewhere I sort of vaguely remember that in some country, when similar guidelines and regulations were being laid out, a time period of 5 years was given for organizations and individuals to come up to the standards so that they can meet those regulations. Why this is important is this thing needs time. Organizations need time. There should be a structure and a regulation and a guideline or whatever, the whole matrix, to educate people and do away with ignorance and recognize that, yes, you need time to come up to certain standards. We are laying down these standards. Because finally, I feel them and us, we're all in the same boat. And finally, government people, who are they? You and I, we could be sitting there in the government offices, making the same GR. I'm saying this because a lot of times we are not aware of the consequences, the impacts that we are creating. So down the 2 decades that this field has developed, we probably are not really aware. There is no data to tell us this is the impact we have created. The GR, the government probably was not aware of the possible impacts of the GR. I don't know. Just a thought. So are we in a mad rush now suddenly? Will we allow ourselves and will the government allow us some time for us to come up to a certain standard like they seem to have done in some foreign country? What is our goal? Goal clarity. What is our goal? Do we need to control, regulate ourselves? Does the government need to do that, or do we need to empower? Do we need to increase the joy? What exactly is our goal? Because that probably will help us define the path we are taking. I think the most important thing for the government is I would like to look at the government as extremely approachable. You are my leader. You know, you interact with Forest Department, Archaeological Survey of India. Culture, youth, this, that, outdoor education, which is education, and then there is Akshay saying, hey, you know what, this should not be under sports. I don't understand all that. I just want to take out people safely. Please help me, you are my leader. But I should feel approachable to this government, come on. ATOI, very strong feeling, ATOM, very strong feeling, ajao, we are there for you. So that is great. The one of the biggest leadership qualities. We need wise guidance. We need providing resources for training and networking. Kahan hai? First aid courses kahan ho rahe? Wilderness first aid. Bahut mehenge hai. Provide subsidies. So there are 2 organizations in Maharashtra which have sponsored. Chota sa, matlab funds kam hai isliye individuals for going. So funds are available. But the government is a huge machinery. ATOI, ATOM, or also can potentially become really huge. ATOI, I'm sorry, Akshay, is probably really huge. But are we willing to look beyond activity skill programs, soft skills, wilderness first aid? And the biggest thing is, yes, probably first time in India, a GR is coming out. And I'm going back to one slide. So in the terms of Nayan Kotian's biggest thing, role model, will we role model like this through the regulation that is coming in? Or will we be a great role model? So these are my thoughts. We're all together in this, in the same boat. We're struggling. This has happened elsewhere also in the world. So I think we can all relax. It's not so bad. Sad things have happened. But we need to move ahead, and I think this is this has been a remarkable thing where there is a clear thread of common thread of thought being expressed by various people. And very simply, going back to novice to master, in the present context, it's my belief that whether you are a leader, whether you are an outdoor educator, whether you are an instructor in a rock climbing camp or a rafting, or taking children out on a simple camp, the competence is the foundation. Folks, it's such a bad thing, there are people still belaying completely wrongly. Completely. It is frightening to go to a site and actually see people operating belays with children up on the, or why children, even grown-ups, up on the cliff or going down on a rappel. Competence. Experience with reflection.